morning one more time.
Yeah, good morning.
Long time no see. Before we get to the tributes, I just want to say also thank you to Steve and Gloria and KK, KK right there, for putting all this together. So as we come to this time for the tributes, what's going to happen, I'm mostly just the MC. I'm just going to be calling people up and keeping the flow nice and smooth. We have a few speakers that will be coming up to speak on Bermie's, or about Bermie, about just whatever it is that's on their hardwood they've prepared. And then I'm going to have, like I said earlier, just a small little moment in time for those that want to just say something, just ad lib, just whatever they have on their heart. Keep it nice and short, like under a minute. You can like line up over there once you feel like you have something that you want to say. and so the first speaker that we're going to be having is someone who's been here for, I want to say, since the start of this church. And she has been very much like, I think, a backbone to this church, someone who's always so in the mindset of serving and putting others first and doing what they can to help someone else. And I can't think of anyone better to start off these tributes to Pastor Bermie than Sandra, KK.
Births. We had births, a lot of deaths,
And we've had marriages and baptisms. Thank you. We are here because of that. We thank you. Thank you for our town meetings. You value our opinion. We had town meetings and we got to say what we thought about when the holy days were coming and going, or the rent is going up on the hall, and do we want to stay here? And just all the town meetings. There weren't a whole lot of them, but we had town meetings, and it made us feel valued. We had to say, we were with you, together with you, not you just telling us everything. Thank you for our council that you set up, and for listening to us and hearing our ideas and everything. Thank you for those churches in the park. We went down to the park a couple of times. We had church outside. Yeah. We had church at the beach. We got out. Thank you so much for that. And you know, I just want to thank, and I'm not covering everything. These are just the things I remember. Thank you for raising up our next pastor. You didn't leave us alone. You raised us up, Pastor. He said, don't worry. I got this young man. He's energetic. He's educated. He's strong. He's ambitious.
Before the next speaker, I got a few people who emailed in some congratulatory words to Pastor Bermie, so I want to read those off in between some of the speakers. And so the next one is from actually the previous pastor, before Bermie, his predecessor, for those of you that may or may not remember him. He goes by the name of Curtis May. And so he sent an email. He can't be here today, but he sent this. Congratulations, Bermie, for a job well done over the years. Bermie, you and I worked together for a number of years in the headquarters congregation. And after the LA church was reestablished, you became the pastor. I can say we hear good things about you and your family. As you step down as pastor in the LA congregation, I know they will miss you and be very thankful for the many years of service. You and your wife, Carmelita, along with your lovely children, were a breath of fresh air. You helped in cheering up the congregation with your good humor. Your laugh was contagious. I think a lot of members appreciated that. Janice and I wish you and your family the very best as you continue to serve our Savior with peace, love, and great satisfaction. I know that they will miss you and are thankful for your service. May God bless you and your family. hope to see you soon. Blessings and peace. First of January.
Amen.
And so the next speaker who will have come up has also been here, thankfully, for a very long time and has been married in this church. And we're just thankful to have her. She has also been such a loving, serving, just graceful individual. And so the next speaker will be Lori Brooks.
Good afternoon. This is a very special day as we celebrate Pastor Bernie, Carmelita, and his wonderful family that we have here. But I have a question. You know, have you ever found yourself wondering and asking God to show you what you can do to serve Him? What does He require of you? You know, I know I have asked that question. You know, but even after we ask, sometimes we're not sure. We don't know what exactly it is that God wants from us and how we can serve Him. But you know, God has laid out not necessarily the future, a whole future, but He does give us a general sense. He's told each one of us in general what He requires of us, what His requirements are. And in the book of Micah, starting in verse 6, it is as though the people are asking the question, with what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before Him? In other words, how can I serve you? Shall I come with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? But the Lord answers through Micah. In Micah 6:8, God answers the question in three statements. He says, verse 8 says, He has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? And it's in the three statements are here: to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. So what does it mean to act justly? Well, it can mean to treat people with fairness, to not overlook the suffering of others, to care about people regardless of ethnicity, social status, gender, and to not look down on those in unfortunate circumstances. What does to love mercy and kindness mean? It could mean when it's within your power to harm or punish someone, you show compassion and forgiveness. Someone put it this way: mercy looks beyond what someone deserves, so they experience what could only be theirs through benevolence. It involves sacrifice. It is how we react when we are treated poorly. And what does it mean to walk humbly? To realize that we're not above God. To not think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. And to esteem others better than ourselves. So why am I talking about this? Well, for the past almost 20 years, I think it's about 20 years, I think we came back here in 1999, March 4th. For almost 20 years, Pastor Bernie and Carmelita and his family have been examples of this quality, these qualities. They have acted justly. In all my years in this congregation, I have witnessed Pastor Bernie and Carmelita treat each member with love, with fairness, with respect. They so have a heart for those who suffer, for those who are sick, for the disadvantaged in some way. And they don't just do this inside the walls of the church. They go outside the walls of the church and do this. Pastor Bernie has a heart for the homeless. He's under no obligation, but he takes his time and he goes out wherever and he serves them with clothing and food and more so with his love and his friendship. And Carmelita, she's a nurse. She cares for the sick and hurting. You know, and I think if I had to be a nurse, I would want to be in the baby ward where everything's nice and clean. But she works with the sick. She, I know one of the things that she does is she heals, dresses wounds. You know. know, and that's kind of like a stupid job, you know, because it can be smelly, you know, and but she has that heart of love and care and compassion. So they have truly acted wonderfully. They're very, Pastor Bernie and Carmelita, they're kind and they love mercy. They're not harsh with anyone. They overlook offenses. You know, one of the stories I remember Pastor Bernie telling is that, you know, one time, you know, he was kind of reprimanded by a minister, you know, and for something he didn't even do, he wasn't in the wrong, but he didn't feel that it was a time to defend himself. Instead, he let the incident go. He overlooked an offense. And that actually ultimately worked in to his advantage, because that same minister was able to bless him tremendously later on. I think that Pastor Bernie and Carmelita, they walk humbly with God. They recognize that this is God's work, this is God's church, and they never put themselves above that. They never put themselves above anyone. They're both pretty down, actually. You know, very down. I remember when Pastor Bernie first came, the first thing he did was bring the podium down on the floor. It used to be up on the stage, you know, very humble. You know, and he's such an advocate for empowering others, you know, like Jillian and Anthony. And he actually makes personal sacrifices so that they can succeed. And not to mention that he's raised four wonderful children who are so loving and so serving. And I know three of them are here today, so we're just so happy to have you. So we just want to say thank you, Pastor Bernie, Carmelita, and your family. Thank you so much for your wonderful service, for your love, for your friendship, for your humor, which is almost as bad as my husband. and just for everything. We love you guys.
In tribute to Reverend Bermie Dizon. Dear Pastor and Mrs. Bermie Dizon, it is with a sense of deep appreciation and thanksgiving that we share with Grace Community International Congregation in the recognition and celebration of the pastoral leadership you have provided to this congregation through many years of dedicated service. It has been our joy to have been in fellowship with such a spiritual leader, one who is filled with love, wisdom, humility, and who does not cease to preach Jesus Christ and him crucified, dead, buried, and now the resurrected Savior and Lord of all who will believe in him. Pastor Dizon, you are a living example of a man of God who has a shepherd's heart. As your congregation has been blessed through your many years of pastoral leadership, so has the congregation of the First Presbyterian Church of Englewood. Precious memories abound of our many combined services in observing Worldwide Communion Sunday, combined fellowship meals, and occasions of conversation. I have been personally blessed in our many conversations concerning ministry and our pastoral issues that have been filled with your insights. A special tribute as well to your beloved wife, who has faithfully served with you as the First Lady of Grace Communion, and to your children who have spent many of their formative years growing up in the rich nurture of this congregation. You will surely be missed, but we know there are seasons for transition because God is always up to doing a new thing. We wish you well and cover you in our prayers in all future endeavors and endeavors you undertake for our Lord Jesus Christ. And we look forward to the ongoing relationship we are blessed to have with the Grace Community International Church under the leadership of their new pastor. I wonder who that is. God's grace and peace be with you. Dr. K. Our next speaker is someone, you know, this is, it's like the more I say it, I don't want to sound less special, but they've been here for a long time too. But I think everybody's been here for a long time, save for like me. And so I remember this person actually used to go to New Life when it was a church in Pasadena. And they served as, I believe, the assistant pastor for a long time. And the time came when Pastor Bermie asked this individual to go to LA because they needed this person's giftings. They needed their leadership. And this person was so humble and willing and loving to go, to leave their family. Because it is hard to leave a church that you become a part of. It's just as hard as if I asked someone here, like, hey, could you go to this other church for me? I need you there. And this person was willing. And this person chose to do that. And they've been a critical, crucial member and associate pastor since. And so our next speaker will be Mr. Stephen Brooks.
Thank you, Anthony. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Almost afternoon, I guess. Just one slight revision. I wasn't quite that elevated in New Life. I was on the worship team. And Pastor Bermie saw the need for a worship ministry here. And so he asked me to come down here because we had sufficient in New Life. So he says, Steve, I need you to come down and set up the worship here in LA. I'll say something about that. He told me not to get too comfortable with that because he wanted me to transition and have someone else do it. Pastor Bermie knows I tried for years and years and years to move that position off, and I'm still doing it. I love it, so don't get me wrong. It's just that I did try to honor with the pastor. I asked me to do it, but God said, nope, not yet. So anyway, here I am. So, but yes, there are so many different ways that I guess all of us who are giving tribute to Pastor Bermie could go, different ways we could approach it. I decided to take something that stood out to me, has always stood out to me about Pastor Bermie. And I want to address it from the point of view of him being an unsung hero. One definition of an unsung hero is one who does great deeds, but receives little or no recognition for them. An unsung hero is a person who has achieved great things or committed acts of, say, bravery, self-sacrifice, yet is not celebrated or recognized, not to any significant hoopla degree anyway. This may be someone who acts bravely in battle in a war without notice, or someone who simply self-sacrifices for the good of the group, yet without recognition. Unsung heroes are not celebrities. You won't see their names plastered on that marquees of theaters. You won't see their names on billboards, their faces on the side of buildings like LeBron James. But they give of themselves for the greater good. Not slamming LeBron James. I'm glad he's with the Lakers. But Pastor Bermie falls in the category of one who may not have his face on a building like that. Yet at the same time, he acts nobly, as we heard Gloria say. Their lives inspire. And yet they receive no parades. They don't receive any holidays in their name. They largely go unnoticed. That's why he, to me, Pastor Bernie, is an unsung hero. He does not and has never drawn attention, at least not intentionally, to himself. Even though he's been at the forefront of many powerful, wonderful ministries and services. You know, there were times when, with all his activity, the services that he would lead, sometimes the response he would get would not be praise. It would be criticism. It would be, you know, reprimand. It would be rebuke rather than accolades or praise. Yet, his entire approach is to answer the call of Jesus and to follow the lead of the Holy Spirit, regardless of whether he receives any credit. And as was mentioned earlier, he is a model of spiritual humility. Something else about him, he never throws his weight around. He's a senior pastor, and he's worn many other high titles along with that. But he doesn't throw his weight around. He doesn't pull rank, as it were, just simply to advance his agenda. There have been times where he could have, in our congregation, and probably in other congregations he pastors, there are times where he could exercise his position as a lead pastor, as a senior pastor, to enforce final decisions on certain issues that may come up. He could put down and say, I'm a pastor, this is it. But rather, sometimes he hears that inner voice saying, the wiser approach would be, in this case, to submit to the decisions made by those under him. And that's what he has chosen to do every time. He deflects credit or glory for his roles and accomplishments, and he's always pointing to whom they really belong. You know, you've heard him say many times, even though he's our senior pastor, he says, well, God, Jesus, is our pastor. He says, this is not the church of Bermie Dizon. This is the church of Jesus Christ. Right? Now, I think there's one thing that all unsung heroes have in common, and that's this. Although they are mostly anonymous, kind of in the shadows, behind the scenes, as it were, yet they all have a powerful impact. I think of Pastor Bermie as being like that quiet storm in the way he influences. You know, God may not be in an earthquake, God may not be in the wind, but he's in that still small voice. That's how I think of Pastor Bernie's influence. I want to share a personal story about Pastor Bermie. He was my mentor when, as I mentioned, he asked me to transfer to L.A. And this was in the early 2000s. What was it, 1999, 2000? You remember, 2000. And shortly afterwards, he ordained me as a deacon. And oh, by the way, yes, he did our wedding. We counseled with him, and he must have worked with us together. He ordained me as a deacon. And then in the course of time, he started dropping these little subtle hints in the beginning, but they became overly more direct suggestions that I should consider becoming an elder. So I agreed, I said, okay. So I was ordained an elder, and eventually, as was mentioned, I was given the license to serve as associate pastor for this congregation. And I mention all that for these reasons. First, by having me come to Los Angeles, Pastor Bermie provided me with many opportunities for service and growth that I don't think I would have ever received any other way. He was generous, as we all know, in presenting opportunities for the whole congregation to participate, right? For speaking, service, leadership. He opened that up to the whole congregation. He wanted to equip every single one of us, right? And he never took it upon himself to do everything by himself. So I personally benefited from those opportunities that he presented. And the second reason is, well, I was growing as a new elder, growing up in my role, and in his mentoring of me, he never sat me down as if I were in a classroom where he'd wrap the table and say, okay, Steve, this is beginning eldership 101, or later on, this is advanced pastorship 503, you know, where he was saying, this is how to do it, listen, pay attention to me. He never did that. Yeah, he was still my teacher, nonetheless. He taught many by example. Now, I do remember there were times he would have to talk to me about specific areas that I could work on. He would give me specific instructions, encouragements, corrections here and there. But I think for the most part, I learned by just observing him, watching him interact, watching him teach not only me, but the congregation in general. I learned from that. And the end result of all this, he had a powerful impact in my life. I'm a stronger Christian because of him. I am more spiritually grounded. I feel more personally empowered, as my wife mentioned, and I've become more experienced in the various areas that are related to pastoral leadership. Above all, I've learned the deeper meaning of selfless leadership, sacrificial service, commitment, patience, persistence, and grace. So Pastor Bermie, you may not receive all the earthly accolades and attaboys that you're entitled to as a servant of the Lord. But I know that's not what you're really seeking anyway. But for us in the Los Angeles congregation, I just want to say, and I think I speak for pretty much all of us, that you are our hero. And Carmelita, you too. You are a hero as well. You are a wonderful example of a godly woman of faith. And your quiver of arrows, you know, your four wonderful children, offspring, powerful examples in their own right, and they're just an inspiration to all of us, the whole family. I'd like to end with this encouraging word from Scripture, Hebrews 6, verse 10. It's a familiar scripture, but I want to read it in the contemporary English version. God is always fair. He will remember how you helped his people in the past and how you are still helping them. You belong to God, and he will not forget the love you have shown his people. So thank you, Pastor Bermie, and Carmelita Dizon, from the bottom of our hearts. The LA congregation will not forget the love you have shown to us.
Thank you for following and the lead of the Spirit and listening to what God's will is for your life. You were born and raised in the Philippines. You could have stayed there if you wanted to. But God gave you dreams of working amongst African Americans. And he called you all the way across the world.
Yeah.
And you started your ministry when you were 26, 27 years old, just about my age. Young and insecure, and yet in spite of that, you followed your Lord Jesus, in spite of that. And so I want to thank you for that, because if it weren't for you following the lead of the Spirit, you wouldn't have had this desire to invest in the next generation. And God called Anthony Walton, to grow up in New Life, that you pastored, and that you were basically almost like a father to Anthony, a mentor, and eventually years later, while he was in college, he was inspired to go into the internship program. And if Anthony Walton didn't go into our denomination's pastoral internship program, he wouldn't have given me that story 4 years ago. In 2014, we met at a conference. I'd never met Anthony before. He just comes up to me and says, "Hey, are you Jillian? I kind of heard about you from your pastor, and you really want things that you would be really good in pastoral ministry." And so Anthony tells me about this internship program, and I go into it because of the story of his pastor, Pastor Bermie, encouraging him to go into this program of leadership. And I would have never thought, I would have never seen myself in this kind of work, this vocation. And I just thank you for speaking through Anthony and pouring into his life. And that in my experience being in the internship program, I graduated from that, and he recruited me here to work with my church family. And if you didn't recruit me here, I wouldn't have met my husband. So thank you for that. Thank you for giving us premarital counseling. We're still together after almost 5 months. So.
To the LA congregation. So we didn't have a pastor. And when I kind of realized that Pastor Bermie was going to be our pastor, and we were moving back to L.A., and here's this guy with this funny name. And he's from the Philippines. So, you know, is this, how is this going to work out, you know? And what I remember is that we were going through changes. The denomination was going through changes at that time. I like to say we were moving from Moses to Jesus. We were moving from the law to grace. That was very, very important. And so when I looked at Pastor Bernie, you know, one thing I found out immediately, because it came through loud and clear, he loved his wife and he loved his children. So that kind of calms you down a little bit, because a man who loves his wife and loves his children, chances are he loves others, including God. And so we were going through these changes, and Pastor Brendan is the one who led this congregation through those changes. And I think he did it very successfully, even though it was not he who's doing it. We understand that. But that was very important to me, and very important to the congregation, because it was those times were critical, very critical, because, you know, if you say grace, somebody will leave. You know? And so he taught grace. He taught, you know, that all this freedom in Christ. And so he kind of led this congregation through that. And so I'll always remember you for that. You're a very humble man, and even though the world thinks that humility means weakness, but humility is really strength. And so he has shown that, and so we appreciate it, and we appreciate you. And wherever you're going, I'm sure you'll take the same thing with you. And so we appreciate you and what you've done for this congregation by way of Jesus Christ.
So now I want to give the opportunity for just, I don't know, like 10, 15 minutes. For those of you that want to say something, that don't have something formally prepared, you can come line up over there if you want to. And keep it short, about a minute, and then I'll close this off with my own final words. So, Louie, I've seen you raising your hand since the start.
You're going to guard me. Hear me. Hey guys.
Hi.
I'm going to talk about the Berlinist family. Though I haven't met your son Abel, I would love to meet him wherever he is. After church, I mean, after. But I just want to say, you guys are like my family, Bermie and Carmenita. You guys are like a mother and a father figure, and David's like a brother figure. You know, all I want to say is I'm going to miss you guys, but you know, you guys are always welcome to visit my house. I want to thank you for everything you've done for us. So, I bless you, and thank you for the hug.
He was in a hurry, and he didn't care that I didn't know how to put it in or do that. And so I said, what am I going to do? And Mr. Dizon walked up. I didn't know him. And he said, ma'am, look, wait when you see Mr. Curtis make, after he does the prayer, he'll come back to the curtain, give it a few seconds. Don't go out yet. Wait. There you go out. And he saved me, even though the man who worked there didn't care. I didn't know him, didn't know I was going to know him later, but never forgot it because he saved me.
One other thing I was planning on doing is not everyone is comfortable coming up to a microphone to speak since it can be intimidating. And so when we're eating after church, I was thinking of having just I'll bring the mic and this little amp over there and give a moment there while we're eating for anyone else who has something while you're like sitting there kind of just thinking about it to speak about anything that you have for Bermie during that time. But, Rose?
I just wanted to say that as I was thinking earlier, I think I might be the person that has known Bermie and Carmelita the longest. We met in 1982 in Orr, Minnesota at S&P. He was working in
laundry.
And in custodial, and so that would be 36 years. So I knew them before they were even married, and so we got that wonderful experience of being 4 years where, you know, living in a college situation, it's very intimate, and really got to know them very well. But what I want to say is not as much about the pastorship, because I haven't experienced it as much as them as my friends. And I was going through those stages of life, of getting married, of having children. And I want to commend the two of you for, you can accidentally have one accomplished child, but that doesn't happen four times. Not without intentionality, a great deal of work, sacrifice. And the family is the foundation of society. And an amazing family is outstanding, and you have an outstanding family, amazing family. I think I'd like to, Carmel were in the same grades together, but I got to bond with baby David because at SAP, he technologically did my presentation for me, and I was stuck, and I don't know the words for anything that he did, or even know how he did it. I will never know how he did it, but he made my presentation that I had to give a chapel amazing, and so I felt I'm really honored to get to know you. But I want to compliment you on a parenting job, an amazing parenting job, and I look forward to continuing to our friendship to grow. But yes, I think I'm going to leave that for longer.
Every memory has been encouraging. I know he's always been there. I came here when I was about 4 years old. He's watched me grow this whole time. He's always been there. I remember sometimes I'd be going through things during the week. I didn't really know necessarily anybody else know. But messages of encouragement he would give me. And sometimes, you know, I really needed that to get through the week. And it was always like very heartwarming for me. And like everyone, I want to thank you for everything that you've done. You as well, Miss Dizon. I've always really liked you a lot. And ever since I was a child, you always say, hey, how you doing? And ask me how it was going, everything in my life. And I always, you know, saw you. I looked up to David and everyone in the Dizons. I remember Ben as well, Abel. I was always like, wow, they're so cool. They can play instruments, they can do this. They don't know how to talk, have to say. David's always dancing. Yeah. I just want to thank you guys, and I'm going to miss you a lot. So, thank you.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Mr.
Dizon, I just want to tell you that we're going to miss you so much. And I'm remembering when I first saw David, it was in 1998, and you were holding him on your shoulder, and he was looking at all of us with this scowl. Like his hand down, and he'd come back up, and we were still there. So he closed his eyes and went to sleep. And probably 98, you would have been three. So 20 years?
I'm sorry. Yeah.
So that's my memory of the design of David. That's why he's so special. All of the kids and David, I was like, oh, who's that cute little boy? And he's tired of us. So we had the insert, and it says, you brought the message of God's word alive in so many ways through your inspiring sermons, your dedication to our family, and your desire to be an example of Jesus' love to others. You are and always will be a blessing to us and your new church family. Thank you.
And mine says, if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you.
Amen.
And now, may the Lord of peace himself give you his peace at all times and in every situation. The Lord be with you all. And I'd like to say thank you, Mr. and Mrs. Dijon, for always being encouraging, engaging with everyone, no matter who they were. And my memory, 18 years ago, is when we baptized at Cabrillo Beach. It was really a blessing, and we'll miss you every Saturday to be good.
So thank you so much, Pastor Bermie, for everything that you've done for the past 20 years. There's not enough words to say for how grateful all of us are here today, but we have something that we want to give and thanks, and I'll let Steve take over from here.
I love this part. We are going to have a double presentation today, Dizon's. Now, you are our pastor. You are leaving, however, you're still our pastor. And we still appreciate you. Put those two together, you have pastor appreciation. We wanted to give you a final appreciation acknowledgement before you left. And again, because time is of the essence, I'm not going to recount all the things that you've done and given us over the years. And, you know, we just need to focus on what's happened the past year, you know, because the last time we did this, so much has happened. And now it's in the culmination of transition, and everything has to have a transition, right? Things change. It's for growth. It's for advancement, maturity. But you're not leaving us high and dry. So we just want to say our one final time how much we appreciate you. Thank you for everything that you've done. You too, Mrs. Dizon. You are half the ministry. You're the silent 50% of everything that happens in the pastorship. So I want to thank you very much for that on behalf of all of us here in Los Angeles. So you have probably noticed that, well, if you haven't noticed, it will appear in your pay that we have given you a bonus of $1,500 as a gift. By way of saying thank you. And rather than these huge unwieldy gift baskets that we used to give to Mrs. Dizon, we give you something that's equally effective but a lot smaller, and that's a gift card. Thank you very much. This is our last official time to show our appreciation in this format. So we want to thank you again for the almost 20 years that you have given us, the LA congregation. And because you are leaving, we wanted to send you not only an appreciation gift, but we wanted to send you a parting gift from us. Can I ask you, the gentleman, your two wonderful sons, Ben and David, can you assist me? I just need you to help me with this. Help me with this unveiling. He said he wanted him to sing. Well, that's okay too. But he's right there. He's an excellent keyboardist and singer. Bring it into the shipboard show to the front. This is just our... I know you're familiar with one of those pictures, but we decided we'd kind of dress it up for you and make it this is our goodbye photo for an LA congregation. And we just want to show you. Come up. Yeah, can we have Mr. and Mrs. Dizon come forward? And let's see, Abel, why don't you come forward too? Why don't we have the whole family come forward? Mr. and Mrs. Dizon, Abel, let's have the whole family come forward. And maybe someone can get a shot of this wonderful occasion, this family, as we send them off and express our appreciation. And I hope that you get a little bit of a glimpse of our love because through this photograph that we put together for you. It's just a goodbye photo from us, but we just want to, end up the bag. Oh, and also, there are two cards. This is so, I didn't practice the flow today like normal, but we just have a general card. Maybe can you give this to, can we have that, give it to them?
Yeah,
it's okay. But then we are also signing a larger card in the back. I don't know if we'll be able to get it completed by today, but please, if you can, everyone, go to the back. There's this nice huge card that we're having on the table where we're going to sign for behalf of Pastor and Mrs. Dizon. So, again, thank you again. God bless you. And we know you're going to come back and visit us. So we're not going to say bye. We're going to say see you later.